Our keynote speaker, Mr. Sam Pitroda, pointed out yesterday that most of the clicks on the websites of interesting knowledge-based initiatives which the government of India is running are actually from outside of India. And this state of affairs is pretty common, even to social enterprise. Indian entrepreneurs who are addressing grassroots problems continue to be supported by funds that are essentially non-Indian. This brings us to the curious case of the missing Indian investors. It's a power-packed discussion which is aimed at understanding the gaps, inhibitions, and psyche of the Indian investor. It will also try to explore how impact investments have successfully worked worldwide and how they can be translated into action in India. I would like to invite Ms. Rohini Nilekani, our moderator for this panel. Rohini is the founder of Argyam Foundation. She's an ex-journalist, writer, and a philanthropist, and she's been deeply involved in development issues for many years now. Please give her a big hand, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Rashesh Shah, Chairman Edelweiss Group, please. Rashesh has over 20 years of experience in public and private markets in India. His focus on innovation and his passion for growth through expansion into related and adjacent markets has been a key differentiator for Edelweiss. I'd like to invite Mr. Shri Kumar Mishra, CEO of Milk Mantra. Shri is now in a perpetual state of entrepreneur turmoil, founding Milk Mantra and constantly striving to give Milk Mantra an outstanding product and brand development edge. He's trying to create an enterprise that everyone who is involved in can be proud of, while at the same time making real sustainable development possible to the lives of rural farmers in Odisha. I'd like to invite Mr. P. Pradeep, Chief Investment Officer, Avishkar India. Pradeep is the CIO and board member of Avishkar Venture Management Services. He's based in Chennai and oversees new investments and support to existing portfolio companies for both microfinance and SME funds, which are run by Avishkar. Our next panelist, Mr. Sasha Mirchandani, founder of K Capital. Sasha is managing partner at K Capital, an early stage seed fund. He's co-founder of Mumbai Angels, India's first angel investment group. Our next panelist is Ms. Padmini Somani, director Salaam Bombay Foundation. Padmini is the vision and force behind Salaam Bombay Foundation that started in 2002. Her commitment to the cause of tobacco control had her proactively involved in the oncology outreach program of the Prince Ali Khan Hospital, Mumbai. Our final panelist, Mr. Mahesh Murthy, founder, Pinstorm, and managing partner, Seed Fund. Mahesh has over 26 years of marketing and communications experience, of which 15 are in the online marketing sphere. Please give them all a big hand, ladies and gentlemen. I now hand over the panel to Rohini. Thank you.
Thank you. Sarvana, namaskar. When I'm in Bombay, I get a chance to go back to my mother tongue at least for that much time. So, we are six panelists, we have 1 hour 15 minutes. We have been asked to solve the mystery of the previous case. This investor, in fact, investor was missing. At the end of it, if you have some clues, that would be great. The way we have decided to structure this is each panelist will get about 3 minutes to give his or her spiel. Then I will ask them a round of questions and we'll open it all up to you. So, if someone can give us a 10-minute sort of cut-off, that would be great. So, well, let me start from this side. Let me start, do you want to go first?
Some of the things that we've been grappling with since we were introduced to the subject, first I must say that the session has been very interesting. So I think it set us all thinking. But from a completely layperson's perspective, I think the first thought which came to my mind was just the very challenge about defining social impact investing from the perspective of an investor. And I think that there are a lot of questions which get raised about why we should consider, as an investor should consider, investing in an entity which has a social, okay, let me rephrase this, has a social perspective and not the business perspective at its core. Now, at some level, this is obviously blasphemous to say, and since I come from the philanthropy sector, it's sort of counterintuitive for someone like me to say that social good is not the driving force of the business. But if I have to turn it on its head, I'll say that if I was to say that from our own perspective, large sustainable businesses have had to serve society to sustain themselves, to grow. And so just the fact that we're straitjacketing this investment into a small bucket of social impact investment, we're actually underselling ourselves, and maybe that's a problem. So one of the questions I'm asking is whether our nomenclature has limited us in the way we've presented this as a business opportunity.
So you can
A couple of years back, I think it was 2002 or 2003, my father got a phone call from a friend of his who was a very large industrialist in northern India. And he said, in Hindi, he said, my father's name is Gulu. He said, Gulu, I've made a lot of money in my life, I've got something to give back. So he said, my son is doing a lot of venture investing and maybe I'll send him across to meet you next time he's in your home city. And he'll maybe give you his two bits on what you can do with this excess cash of yours. So I went across, and he's an old man, he's done very well. He was today he's a billionaire, he was already very rich in that time. And I gave him some ideas on what I thought he could do with his excess money. He was there was room, there was his sons, his daughters participated. I remember his wife participated in the meeting. We just had an informal chat about some ideas of how he could do, in today's words, impact investing. Several months passed, and I didn't hear from him, and I was busy with my own life. And one day, I met him at an airport, and I said, "Sir, kya ho gaya?" You know, he said, "Wo sab chhod do, hum log to mandir mein hi denge paisa." So that was our country in 2002, 2003. The whole idea in our country was the rich were giving. It's not like we keep reading these news articles that no one's giving. They're giving, but they're giving to what they feel comfortable with. And they just feel that in their communities, they can give back to a temple. Why not? Because they're getting back something from God. And that was how India was, and it still is, in 2011. There are many, many challenges, ladies and gentlemen. My view is there are plenty of very, very interesting funds that have come into this country. Some of them are sitting on this panel, and some are in the audience. And I call it version 1.0. They've done the hard work in the last couple of years of coming to the ground here, helping out, doing things, putting actually institutional money on the ground. And I call it version 1.0. And I think that we are now moving towards version 2.0, which is the mature money. You get better quality of entrepreneurs. You have Sri on the audience here. People like him who understand business. So there's a combination effect. And I think that's going to be an explosion. There's a $1 billion opportunity, I think. Monitor predicted that $1 billion will go into sectors like water, low-income housing, and other sector. I think it was, healthcare was one of the other sectors. This fourth sector, I can't remember. So there's $1 billion of actual institutional money coming in the next 4 or 5 years, which is very exciting. I think the government has to be more involved, because without government help, really nothing can move. So these are some of the initial issues, and I can discuss more. But I think I'm excited. I think there's a big opportunity. I think good things are going to happen in the next couple of years.
Well, I can't resist. I chair Pratham Books, and we think we've reached 25 million kids with books.
Wow. So you're already getting there.
Publishing part of Pratham. But in 7 years, we've reached 25 million. But you're right, we need to reach 300.
The scale of the challenge is big.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah. I'm so sorry. Shit. Sorry.
I think earlier I had the same, issue of, I was asking my colleagues, what is impact investing? Because I think the way the entire structure has been and is, we have NGOs or the philanthropy sector, and I think increasingly there is a lot of capital going there, because I think there are a lot of people who have made money giving back and all. And it has its own issues and challenges about how to channelize capital, how to make sure those NGOs and other organizations are adequately resourced. And then we have the, you know, the commercial part of it, which is investing. And out there also, I think India has evolved a lot. A lot of capital flows through the market, through private equity funds, through all of that. So I think there is a commercial part of it and there is an NGO part of it. Even in the commercial part, we have issues like early stage startup companies find it hard to raise capital, angel investors are not there. So those issues are there, but still they have both evolved a lot. And I think with impact investing, there is a need to create this third category of what are called social enterprises who are trying to mix commercial objectives and social objectives, who are not NGOs and for only philanthropy. They're also making commercial returns. And I think there is a huge issue around this on how to assess them, how to define them, what are commercial enterprises, the entire ecosystem around that, investor education around, you know, how to trade off social objectives with commercial financial objectives. We have had a few cases. I think cases like Amul and all, I think really stand out to being able to create this hybrid. But this hybrid creates some confusion, especially as I think investors, especially the commercial investors, also, you know, they want to understand quickly. They don't want to spend a lot of effort making the trade-offs and understanding nuances and all. So I think the first problem we have is defining this. The second problem we have is a lot of this, even if it is commercially oriented with social objectives, you're catering to the bottom of the pyramid opportunity, I mean, largely. So a lot of impact investment-oriented companies, organizations, you're catering to the, you know, to really be that large mass of people who haven't been catered to up till now. And you are obviously, you want to do it in a commercially viable way. The problem that has emerged, and I think after we saw what happened in the MFI industry, is how do you become commercially viable without being exploitative? Because if you are, you know, if you're exploitative with the upper end of the market, I don't think anybody cares. A Gucci bag can sell for, you know, 8 lakh rupees, and I don't think anybody cares about that. But if you're commercially profitable, viable, and catering to the bottom of the pyramid, there will always be an apprehension that it might, because who calls what is adequate returns? And I think the third problem we have is, even if we can overcome you know, all these issues, we still have the ecosystem issue is, how does the market intermediation work? How do the funds get channelized? I think on the NGO side, foundations have been there for hundreds of years. People have been giving money. It has evolved a lot. Even commercial side has evolved a lot. Here, there is no ecosystem. Obviously, I think Sankalp and other forums will hopefully, play the role of bringing investors and these social enterprises close to each other. But I think that entire ecosystem, which can hopefully, you know, alleviate some of the confusion, clarify the, you know, how to assess it. But even all those things are absent currently.